The Russian artist Kazimir Malevich once said, "We can only perceive space when we break free from the Earth, when the point of support disappears."
The Bergisel ski jump towers 250 meters above Innsbruck, an instrument for high-performance sport, shaped with mathematical precision. Its creator is Zaha Hadid, an architect whose buildings defy classification and even gravity.
Zaha Hadid flies in the face of convention and far into the future. Without that element of uncertainty, she says, that sensation of traveling into the unknown, there would be no progress. In the last 30 years, Zaha Hadid has gone from paper architect to global megastar. Her extraordinary architecture doesn't just stand. It melts, it slides, it whooshes, it juts, it moves. Her buildings make us feel like we're in another place, another world even, a Zaha-shaped world. Zaha Hadid has won all the top architecture awards, the Pritzker Prize for Architecture and the Sterling Prize, twice. This year, she's even been named Businesswoman of the Year by Veuve Clicquot. Born in Iraq in 1950, Zaha Hadid is now a dame of the British Empire.
Zaha's story is absolutely fabulous. She is the greatest woman architect, not in the world now, and probably ever lived. And she's right here, you know, in London. You can touch her, well, almost.
She does demand attention, and she gets it. She goes to the States and she has dinner with Obama. She is a superstar.
She's a fantastic gossip. She loves to hear about people. She's a great mimic. She's a person that you wouldn't want to leave the room at dinner with for fear that you're going to find yourself as a subject of conversation. She is the nearest thing in architecture to the round table at the Algonquin.
She relishes form. So form for her, whether it is something form that she draws, or form that she wears, or form that she lives with, it's about an all-encompassing vision. She is a complete work of art.
Zaha is, if you know her and if you understand her, very inspiring person. But you have to have patience. You have to give her room. If you try to constrain her, then she will explode.
The winner is a great architect who happens to be a woman, Zaha Hadid.
Thank you very much. My old accountant, he used to always tell the tax people that I was a ditzy princess from the Arab world. Not knowing that I came from a family who did not believe in the monarchy, but anyway. Architecture is no longer a man's world. This idea that women can't think three-dimensionally is ridiculous. And I cannot say I've done it alone. I have great people. I have a great partner, Patrick Schumacher. I have great associates with me in the office who are a mixture of men and women. And they've all really contributed to this work.
Yeah, an old school building.
So that was a school building?
This was an old school, but when we arrived, it was converted into a series of studios. Here's still the girls' entrance, the other side is the boys' entrance.
You don't apply that rule today anymore.
Not anymore. And we have now, we had one studio, and now we, of course, have the whole complex.
It's an almost improbable success story. It took years for her career to take off. The practice started life in just one room with four people and now employs almost 400. It's a global brand with buildings all over the world.
And we broke through here.
Yeah.
There's a kind of reception. You want to see the main meeting room?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But where, I wonder, is Zaha?
What kind of technology to produce this model?
Most of them are printed. Now we have our own 3D printer.
Does Zaha come to this meeting?
Yes. Actually, when she comes to the office, she's sitting here and is holding court, if you like.
Ah, today it seems she's holding court at home.
So what we want to know is the nickname.
No,
what do you call Patrick?
Potato.
Potato.
He has many names, Patrick. Potato, Fluffy, Cappuccino, Singapore.
Would you mind interpreting?
Choo choo. No, because Patrick does not respond to anything. So you say, Patrick, Patrick, Patrick. And then 10 times later, and you have to have a name. You say, choo choo. And he says, yes. But potato happened a long time ago because he's German. And cappuccino because he's fluffy. I would say, oh, where is Fluffy? So we spent our day every day looking for Patrick for at least 4 hours.
Because he's off somewhere.
Because he's never on his desk or he's somewhere there. And yeah, we're all looking for Patrick.
So so that's a tower, so that perspective, as you said.
It looks like a showroom, but it isn't. It's home. Many of these things Zaha designed herself. She's loved playing with shapes, moulding her own world, ever since she was a child in Iraq. It was here, growing up in Baghdad in the 1950s, that Zaha Hadid's vision of the world began to take shape. It was a beguiling marriage of the old and the new, of tradition and modernity.
Zaha, I'm looking at a picture of a little girl in a garden in Baghdad. It's full of mystery, really. Do you recognize her?
Yeah, I remember that picture.
What's she thinking, I wonder?
I don't know. I was preoccupied with something. I don't know what it was.
You were.
I was a very curious child.
Why? You mean you were curious about the world?
About everything, yeah. So I used to walk around all day, and I was almost like an only kid because my two brothers were already abroad. So I used to run around all day asking questions. And so by the end of the day, my mother's had enough. So when my father appeared back at home, and he was very patient. He asked any questions I wanted to know.
Zaha's father, Mohammed Hadid, was the leader of the Iraqi National Democratic Party. He'd been educated in England. It was a cosmopolitan household.
It's so extraordinary, this childhood of yours in Baghdad, because the way you describe it, it's such a civilized place.
It was an amazing place, really. Great people, very open society, fun.
You traveled a lot. Here's another lovely picture of you.
Of me in Rome.
In Rome. And then I've also got this picture of you with your parents in Rome here.
Yeah, the same trip. I think.
You look like a child who was loved.
No, I mean, I had a fabulous childhood. You know, I went to an amazing school, a nun school. It was an interesting time.
It was also, you were a Muslim girl in a convent.
And the same with the Jewish girls. We were obliged to go to chapel and pray. And then I used to go home and wondering why my parents are not praying.
And they finally told me that, you know, well, we're not really Christians. And so I thought at the time, so why do I have to do that, you know? So we were allowed not to go to chapel for prayers. So we were brought up with that moment where, you know, there was an interest in education, there was also interest in architecture. And so I think it was an interesting time.
Architecture was seen as a means by which Baghdad could build a new identity. The city looked to the A-list of modern architects. Frank Lloyd Wright, Alvar Aalto, and Le Corbusier were all invited to design plans. Walter Gropius's university building still stands as testament to Baghdad's belief in modernist ideas.
I think Zaha was given the sense that she could achieve whatever she wanted. It was a place in which modernity was just arriving. Baghdad, when she was a child, was watching Le Corbusier buildings going out. There was a Gropius building. The regime before the dictatorship was open to Western ideas and believed that women had a place in that. And that was something that was deep in her mind, and she eventually picked it up and ran with it.
Looking at the interior of your parents' house, and this very beautiful picture.
Yeah, it's
of the
beautiful.
Room.
Yeah, the interior is very nice.
And those wonderful tiled floors.
Yeah, they're beautiful.
Simple but beautiful cane furniture.
This chair, these seats actually were not cane. They were made of steel.
Wow.
They were woven steel and painted gold. This is the summer mode. You don't see a carpet on the floor.
No.
In the winter, there'll be a rug, a big rug.
It's interesting, though, because you're 8 or 9 years old and you already know the layout of the furniture in the room.
Yeah, I remember this very, very, very well. I wanted things to be done my way, but I wanted an adult's room and I didn't want a children's room. So I had designed this room, which my parents made for me. And actually, it was a very popular room. So my cousin had one, my aunt had one. So the whole family had one of these rooms.
You designed the whole suite?
Yeah, it wasn't that very...
Isn't that a bit unusual?
I think maybe by 11 years old, I was already wanting to become an architect. And my generation, there were lots of women who wanted to become an architect. It was not uncommon. And there were some women who were in the older generation who were already, you know, practicing in Baghdad and...
That's another weird thing for people, thinking about what people might think of Baghdad today.
Yeah,
the idea that women were treated...
No, I think that, you know, I think what was interesting about that period, you know, people had a kind of a some level of freedom, that there was not such a weird thing to do. You know, I thought I can design clothes, you know. So I designed clothes which didn't work, you know. But my mother would make me wear them so I can, you know, learn a lesson. But actually, what was weird, instead of it was a punishment, but actually my friends all loved it because they've never seen anybody dressed like that, you know. I would change the sleeve and make it, cut it off or have a thing made which looked silly. They thought it looked silly. I thought it looked great. And my friends all thought it was amazing. I think the only way, the reason I got away with it is because I didn't like anything. You know, I was always like, this thing itches me, it doesn't work for me. So my mother, you know, said, okay, I give you a salary, like a pocket money, £5 a month. And with that, you can, if you want, you can go shopping. Because she didn't want to be involved anymore in buying my clothes. So I, by age of 7, 8, I can choose my own things. And I used to always, I was astonished by other people that their mothers would pick their things for them. I mean, they were both, my parents were very liberal. I don't know whether, I mean, you know, I wasn't privy to this, but they decided to let me, you know, experiment and see how far it goes.
That sounds so like the Zaha we know. That sounds like you.
Yeah, well, that's how I was.
Yeah, and that's how you are.
The only thing is that I was very shy. Well, maybe I'm still that.
She may have been brought up in Iraq on the edge of the desert, but in 1972, Zaha went from the Arab world, where modernists were admired, to London, where architecture was in crisis. Buildings which had once seemed like solutions to post-war housing issues now seemed like problems.
The only conclusion that we can come to is to pull a bloody lot down.
Architecture was badly in need of new ideas and a new direction. There was one place, however, that had imagination and vision. The AA, the Architectural Association in Bedford Square, was an incubator for progressive ideas and innovation. It was this school that Zaha headed for in 1972.
This most radical of schools in the world sits and sat at that time in Georgian houses in Bedford Square. And I think that's really indicative that we occupied a historic building, but in a very unexpected way. So it was literally a house of creativity.
Just at the time that the British economy was really going down the drain, it stopped building anything anyone was interested in, it found itself with perhaps the most powerful and inspiring architecture school on the planet.
The visionary chairman of the AA at the time was this man on the elephant, Alvin Boyarsky.
The AA under Alvin Boyarsky was all about exploring differences right out to the sort of tentacles that they could go to. And so it was literally explosive because people were in competition, as it were, but in a way the energy went to everybody.
It was very anti-design. And it was almost a moment of anti-architecture. The focus was that previous ideas did not work. Let's have alternative life.
Alternative life meant experimentation, testing noise in a warehouse, or converting an old bus. Students and teachers even set up a farm in Wales. But not Zaha.
I didn't want to go to Wales, and I wasn't going to do an inflatable bus. Some people did. I mean, the noise from that welding machine, welding that bus, is still ringing in my ear. Then they decided to lift it with a crane, and because they didn't think about how they're going to get out of Ching's yard. So they lifted it from a crane, and then when it landed on the pavement, it just collapsed. All came apart. There were also weird things going on, doing workshops with the first year master tutor, making love with one of his students on stage, and the boyfriend running around trying to kill him, you know. The idea was that you find your, within all that mess, you will find your way.
Oh, very 60s, very
yes,
hippie.
Yes, very 60s.
Yeah.
And we did, because there was no one else to advise us what to do. We had to go, if you were curious, we had to go to every jury in the school, every presentation, and from that suss out what is our next move.
Zaha stormed through the school, trying out all the options on offer before settling on two teachers whom she found inspiring, themselves rising stars of radical architecture.
Any other questions?
She was definitely clearly talented and favoured by her tutors, Rem Koolhaas and Ilya Zengelis.
It was clear from the beginning that she was on a kind of a unstoppable trajectory that would, I mean, it was very clear from the very first moment that she would be a name in the history of architecture.
I'm really eternally grateful to them because they showed me a glimpse of what it could be like.
It was here that Ilya and Rem led her, to the pioneering work of Russian artist Kazimir Malevich and the Russian suprematists. Abstract and groundbreaking, it was these exploding compositions that most inspired Zaha.
One of the triggers for Zaha's ideas about how space might erupt from the ground, how planes might intersect, comes from that period in Russian art. Her fascination for walls that grow out of the ground, of oversailing planes, might initially appear to be unbuildable and impractical in a rectangular world. And yet, as we can see, these things do work.
I mean, Zaha really is a painter. I mean, it's a pity that she doesn't paint anymore so much as she did then. And in fact, it was her painterly approach to composition that was kind of transferred into her three-dimensional architectural compositions, very much like Malevich himself.
Malevich was known as a painter of abstract canvases, but by the 1920s, he was pioneering experimental architectural models known as architectons. Down with cupolas, he said, let wedges cut into the bosom of space.
I do remember this incredible project of Zaha's, which was a series of rectilinear buildings that were scattered at odd angles across London around the river. And the plans and drawings were obviously Russian in their inspiration, but had been applied to the city we all live in. It was fabulous.
London was the destination for Zaha's student project, which transformed Malevich's architecton into a hotel over the Thames. A version of the original painting has Pride of Place on her living room wall.
And that's the Hungerford Bridge, isn't it?
That's Hungerford Bridge, and that's a Malevich tectonic sitting on Hungerford Bridge. And this is one of the very early drawings where, you know, the actual tectonic is also fragmented or broken. So this is in its process of kind of like its orbiting before it lands on Hungerford Bridge.
The plan for Hungerford Bridge was something of a breakthrough for Zaha. It was a time of change, too, for Alvin Boyarsky and the school.
So within 3 years, that whole kind of what I call metaphysical wanking has kind of not dissipated, still carried on, but Alvin, by the late 70s, shifted to what I always call a projected reality. He wanted to push for projects which eventually could be realized.
But Zaha's projects weren't to be realized just yet. After graduating from the AA, she would remain at the school as a teacher.
It's what we all wanted to be at the time. The culture that we were trained in was focused on experiment and on visions of architecture and cities. And most of what was being built, particularly in Britain, was pretty banal at the time.
You wanted it to carry on. I think that's really it, that the research, the excitement of being at the AA, you didn't want to leave.
Zaha took over the unit. It was a it had a reputation as Unit 9. So Unit 9 was first the unit with Rem and myself, and then in the end, after that, it became Zaha's unit.
Those 10 years of AA teaching were, it seemed like 30 years, but it was only 10, were, I think, very instrumental, because everybody knew they were on the brink of discovering something. We didn't know what it was. It was not premeditated. We didn't know what it was. It was just, everybody knew there was so much energy around. There was, you know, such a buzz on the staircase and the rooms, the whole punk thing and the fashion scene and all these costumes on the street. That was a, for London, that was a very exciting time. What was going on? You know, not in architecture.
Yeah, you know, I never thought of you about as a punk, but actually I think you are a bit of a punk.
But the whole atmosphere was about rebellion, you know, and challenging the kind of status quo. Nobody wanted to be normal.
Zaha was not only teaching. In 1979, she founded her own architectural practice. She was teaching by day and drawing and painting by night.
So I used to go out every night. I never drank. So I would come back, and I had this tiny news house, and I had my board there, my big painting. And everybody knew I'll be home after midnight. So people used to, I mean, Nigel, everybody used to honk the horn in their cars or motorbike or whatever, and pop by at 2 in the morning. I was always there. You know, I can paint and talk.
She would watch American Gigolo all through the night, over and over again, enjoying Richard Gere hanging from a bar upside down and doing pull-ups.
But they were always behind, because I, by then, knew every scene in every of these movies. So I can only turn around when I knew that my favorite scene would come up.
But it was the set design of a Hitchcock masterpiece that really caught Zaha's eye.
The other one that she'd have on repeat was North by Northwest. And in that, the mock-up of the UN building does look remarkably like one of hers.
In 1983, when she was 33, Zaha won her first prestigious international competition. It was to design a clubhouse to be located on the mountainside above Hong Kong. Her design was radical, but potentially it was buildable.
The Hong Kong Peak competition paintings were absolutely the sort of, you know, eye-opener of all time. Fabulous sense of colour, for instance. Her three-dimensional grasp is almost beyond everyday comprehension.
This extraordinary huge canvas which evoked the quality of gravity-free building. The peak was an explosion.
Nigel came in and he said, "How are you doing?" And I said, "I don't know, I've just won the peak." He said, "What?" I had juries in the school, and the students from other units all brought champagne and was just completely wild.
The landscape of Hong Kong was as significant in the way it was drawn as the proposal for the building itself. The detail of those urban landscapes was suppressed, as though it was all a kind of rocky outcrop. But within that vocabulary of relatively kind of spiky and jagged forms, you could see already the desire for fluidity.
The peak was the peak and still remains a peak, I think. I have a feeling it still is a guiding, or should be, a guiding light forever.
Despite the brilliance and ambition of the project, Zaha's client lost the site and it was never built.
Did you expect it to happen, or what did you feel when it didn't, and how did you
feel? Well, I was very, it was sad because, I mean, it was like in our grasp, you know, and you know it could happen.
But it didn't, and yet the peak did put Zaha on the map. Her work was attracting the attention of young architects from all over Europe.
Going up here.
Patrick Schumacher was one of them.
So this is the famous Studio 9. That's the first space we had, and that's where I first knocked on the door of Zaha's.
So once it was one room.
That's right.
Or two, and now it's an entire complex of buildings, every one of which you sort of entered and sort of took over. You
squatted one by one, picking up. And now we have another building, as you know.
Patrick first encountered Zaha's work as a student in Stuttgart in 1983.
She had won the peak, and that meant she was published and her publication was circulating around universities. So she was a star, you know, a young star, 20 years before she was known outside as a star.
And what Patrick did next was apply for a job.
I had an interview, not with her actually, with one of her collaborators. This was only a very small group at the time, four people only. And so I was hired and started work, and it was very funny. She didn't acknowledge my existence for the first 4 weeks, roughly.
I opened the door for him, but I didn't want him there.
You didn't?
No.
Why?
I didn't like him. And I didn't want to talk to him. He got on my nerves.
So there was initially no communication at all. Not even a hello, an acknowledgement.
Anyway, I sacked him every week. So he would be upset and he would go for a walk, and there was another guy walk with him to calm him down and say, don't worry, she'll come around eventually.
So it was curious, but I was anyway absorbed in the work. I was getting on quite well.
So how long did it take you for you both to get into a rhythm?
No, I think a few months.
And
he's a really fantastic guy. He's stubborn, my God. But he's been an enormous support to me. And he's also he's a very, very good designer. He's very smart. And I think he's been an incredible asset.
You've got to have an ego, haven't you? And how is Zaha's ego?
Huge.
It was 10 years after winning the peak that Zaha, now working happily with Patrick, completed her first major built project, the Vitra fire station in Germany. Dramatic and abstract, it is unmistakably Zaha Hadid. Hélène Binet has been photographing Zaha's work ever since.
There's never been any building like this. It's an absolute luxury in life to be able to photograph something that you have no reference. So your image is really about discovering, understanding, and not referring to anything else. It's a gift.
From her images, it's apparent that the lines between art, sculpture, and architecture have been crossed. Zaha hadn't just studied Malevich. She had absorbed him.
I could follow the process and be there during the construction site when the moment where it's only concrete, before the door, before the fire alarm, before anything, where it's just structure, just the skeleton, just the concept, the purest you can have. And like here, there will be door later on, but at the moment, it's purely this incredible ceiling, roof, standing on some concrete. So the sense of magic, the sense of sort of pushing the construction technology to the extreme. She always had building where I think the engineer must have had big headache before to start, because she said, I want to just forget about any gravity and let it flow, and it has to be concrete, heavy, but free and light. So that was amazing. She has created incredible signature. Concrete became something else, I think, after her.
Not a bad result for a project which started life not as a building at all, but as a chair. That is what Vitra owner Rolf Felnbaum originally commissioned them to design. So why not the chair? Is that more difficult than a building?
It's not a trivial matter. A chair is quite a difficult product, and we were in a different world. It's a very self-contained object, needs to be neat. We were in a much more explosive, exploratory territory. The furniture we created were more kind of semi-usable, abstract interior landscapes. So that didn't work.
He said, well, you know, maybe the chair is too restrictive. How about if you do the fire station?
It's sort of... How about designing this building?
Yeah, I mean, poor Rob, it was so patient.
It was an extraordinary building in that it actually allowed Zaha to physically realize those early canvases, which were all about slicing blade-like buildings, sharp-edged and like glittering sabers.
We had so many different sketches, approaches, and we were never satisfied. We kept withdrawing and holding back. Rolf said, oh yes, that's great, I want to build that. We said, no, it's not ready, we're unhappy with it.
And I can remember at one stage, Rolf calling me up saying, Dan, does she really want to build it? could she sort of make a few decisions, please? But they're celebrating the 20th anniversary this year, and Rolf is one of her stronger supporters still.
Since completing the fire station in 1993, Zaha has designed many buildings that haven't happened. Her vast archive room contains models of her successes and her failures.
To this day, I'm angry that this was not built, the Cardiff Opera House. It was very buildable, and this would really have not only established her name rather sooner, as an architect who could build, as opposed to merely an architect who could draw and paint and model. But also, it would have been the Bilbao Guggenheim of England and Wales. The crime was Cardiff, you know.
That was really horrible.
I mean, you won it not once, but twice, really.
Three times. I don't know, I mean, it was a very strange situation. I could have easily gone, you know, bitching, crying or whatever, because we were treated very badly. But they didn't want us. I mean, you know, I don't know what they wanted, actually.
Cardiff in the late 1990s was not a place to try to build an adventurous piece of architecture, especially if you were an adventurous Arab. An adventurous Arab woman architect, it was just too much for the city.
I was a non-entity. You know, I was known within the profession here and in London, but in Wales, they didn't know me. They didn't expect me to win it.
The Millennium Commission, which was basically going to be funding most of this, took against Zaha, I think personally, and almost started a campaign against the building. I was told by one of the leading Millennium Commissioners, oh, you know, Hugh, this is unbuildable. Complete nonsense, it's not unbuildable. It was perfectly buildable. It was engineered by every Arab, the same people as engineered the Sydney Opera House. You know, that is not a difficult building to build. And yet this was the propaganda that was being put out at the time.
Many people thought, you know, the drawings we did were so obscure and very difficult to understand. But we do drawings of every kind. The plans and sections are not the same as a normal building, because it's not a square building and or rectangle. That project could be easily done.
There was a lot of prejudice against who she was, and oddly enough, not just because she was of Iraqi origin, or not just because she's a woman, but because she's from London. There was that there as well. You know, you, the Millennium Commission, are parachuting in poncy London architects down to our capital in Wales and telling us that we're going to build some oddly shaped thing. Thanks very much. What's Welsh about that?
I mean, what a drastically bad decision those Welsh guys made. You know, I mean, really stupid. I mean, there they had, you know, this fabulous architect with this fantastic design, and they blew it. You know, they just completely blew it. One could boycott Wales forever, really, just on that basis. Why not?
I think we gained a lot of strength through it and enormous support. You know, I mean, honestly, till very recently, if I'm at the airport or in a restaurant or on the street and people come to me and say we're Welsh, and we're sorry what happened.
It deserved to win the competition. I think it's a masterful piece of work. And I'm just so sad it was never built. That's Britain for you.
Zaha's work has always been distinctive. These paintings, concepts for different projects, are works of art in their own right.
For 10 years, well, maybe 5 years after Cardiff, we were absolutely stigmatized everywhere. Because people thought, oh, it's such a kind of bad karma, bad something, we don't want them.
We did a number of competitions. We lost all of them. And then we...
Why did you lose all of them?
Well, maybe it was too radical, too unusual at the time, maybe too sketchy, and that it continued most throughout the 90s. So we've lost most of what we've been doing for over a decade.
What did it feel like to be in an office where you know you've got this powerful presence and creativity here, and yet you don't win anything?
There was always the optimism and hope that the next one will be it.
The thing that kept me going is that I really enjoyed the work. It was very tough. Actually, the times I enjoyed the most were the toughest moments. We were left to develop these ideas through competitions. I always thought at the end, we'll win.
Competitions are almost an invitation to push the boundaries of possibility and to offer things that other people can't think of. And therefore, that's what she's good at, and that's honed her abilities.
We had no money, and these people just didn't let go. You know, Patrick used to teach in Germany, but he wouldn't charge me for working in London because he knew I had no money. I couldn't pay him. I think in the 90s, honestly, none of us slept. I mean, for 10 years, we were maybe 10 people, but we did work for equivalent to 100 people. It was that increased our repertoire. So when we did get work eventually, no, it wasn't so difficult because we had tested every option. It's only because we worked on every competition, we killed ourselves until we won Cincinnati. In 1 year, we won Rome, Wolfsburg, the ski jump, one after the other.
The flourish with which to exit the wilderness years came in 1999, with her winning entry to design a contemporary museum for Rome, a Baroque city not famed for its modern buildings. You could call Maxi modern Baroque. It seems appropriate that someone who is as much an artist as an architect should design a museum for art and architecture. Completed in 2009, it won the prestigious Sterling Prize the following year.
The museum space of the Maxi is a completely fluid space. And you can see from here how it's not easy to distinguish between gallery and movement space. Concrete can become something incredibly elegant, incredibly beautiful, a smooth, sweet surface that takes you around the building in a beautiful way. It's an architettura dolce, molto dolce. We're in the lobby here. When you see all the movement around, you can think of the Guggenheim by Frank Lloyd Wright. In this case, this is the highest point of architectural excitement, I would say, in the building, because it's where you can see all the galleries. It's a panopticon that lets you understand more or less the organization of the space of the building, so it's most important. But it's also where the people meet.
Look, an actual a card model. And it's getting that sinuousness of the whole building. You've got these deep, very thin concrete blades coming down over your head to mitigate the daylight. You can pick holes in it. There's the old building at the front it kind of erupts from, like some kind of fruiting body. There's always this implication of the buildings like tendrils just going on further, taking over other structures, almost like a kind of a self-generating city.
Fluidity is to do with what we call streams. It's like a kind of a delta of rivers, but they are frozen in time. And by bifurcating and crossing, It also acts as a structure so that it makes it rigid or stable and forms these courtyards.
Rome wanted a gallery for art that did not yet exist, a truly futurist project. Maxi is modern Baroque, fluid Baroque.
We think of the 21st century art as an art. We don't really know what its materiality will be about, if it will be about materiality, if it will be about relations, about movement, about performance, about physical stuff. So the museums, the museum itself is a dynamic concept which transforms itself into space.
It's the most demanding art space one could possibly imagine. There are parts of it which feel like being thrown into a washing machine and spun around on your head, which I find personally rather exciting. And it's something which initially artists find difficult, but they will respond to it and they will find ways to make it work.
The challenge for Zaha was not easy because there wasn't a curator at that time, so there wasn't a clear precise program for the building. So it was somehow the architecture who shaped the life of the museum.
I think that it got a level of attention from Zaha and from Patrick, which maybe once they became globally famous, doing lots of projects all over the world, huge staff, etc. Maybe that level of attention, inevitably, as with all architects at that level, starts to drop off. But this, you know, it's got sort of forensic levels of attention on it. And the fact that it was done really pushing what was possible at a time when a technology was just coming in to make other forms possible makes it significant for me. So I would say, you know, best of early Zaha, Maxi in Rome.
Whilst Maxi was still being built, they won and completed two commissions in Germany, a BMW factory and a science centre in Wolfsburg.
Two very different buildings. The BMW building, I suppose, you could say belongs to the Jagged period, but the Wolfsburg project is a remarkable invention of a building which sits on giant concrete legs like some kind of elephant.
It was like a kind of a Sydney Opera House of its time, by which I mean an architect designs a building which then the technology has to, in a sense, catch up with. How do you build something like this?
It deals with very complex geometries, which are there in nature, clouds and everything, but up until that point, we hadn't imagined them. You hadn't imagined how you draw that or how you make it stand up after you've drawn it. But once you've cracked that, what you suddenly realize is that was a small problem. The bigger problem is how do you make it real? The norms of a horizontal surface and a vertical surface disappear. Things go through a transition. They're neither horizontal nor vertical. Therefore, the interrelationship has to act as one big thing. Now, to simulate the forces of gravity in something like that, rather than pieces and putting it together, was a massive challenge. It took us nearly 18 months to get computers to a level, and we worked with software manufacturers to push the software as we were designing the building to a level where we could actually understand the gravitational forces of that. I'd never admitted to her that this building does not stand up for about 2 years. I could not face the idea of telling her, not only can't we draw it, but I don't think we can actually make it. We'd already won the job and we were starting on site. There is an element of fear in the whole relationship. You know, you don't want to let her down.
The Science Centre in Wolfsburg marked a step change in her practice. It was a conceptual leap away from the jagged towards the elephantine, the snaking, the snail-like. Made easier by what became known as parametricism, of which Zaha and Patrick were pioneers.
Parametric design is fundamentally where you allow the computer, you feed it various ideas, and then you allow it to invent form that you probably couldn't do in your mind. It's of such complexity that your brain couldn't think of it, and your certainly your hand couldn't sketch it.
What has been extremely fertile is to look back at nature and the way it handles complexity. And there are ways of doing this now with the new tools. Because the new tools, first of all, we don't repeat elements. We always vary, iterate, modulate elements. Instead of saying you have only one option, we just give you, nearly random, like nature, you just produce multiplicity. Gratuitously differentiation. And then we look at it, yes, we could use these differences. So there's a kind of evolutionary process of variation, selection, and then reproduction. So like nature would do it. Your hair doesn't grow everywhere the same. It adapts itself to different contours, to different densities. Then you can follow that vector of transformation.
The fact that we can look at things three-dimensionally in the computer, we can stretch them and pull them apart, connects very well with the parametric idea that if you depress a point or stretch it, that the other bits move with it, just as when you're designing a car.
People always misunderstand this whole thing about computing. They think, oh, well, you know, well, they don't know what they're doing, and they're just going to press a button, and the computer does it. I mean, it's of course totally idiotic.
For me, architecture is all about framing social interaction, social communication. And some of our buildings, you get that feeling. There's always that space of flying where you have, for instance, a lobby space where you see things below, above, in layers all around. If you go to buildings now also, you know you need atriums. You need to have an overview. What is happening on all these floors? Who is coming and going? So we need to sense what everybody is doing. So that's why I think these environments are so important. They become interfaces of communication. So in our architecture, with every step, new vistas open and close. So that's this kind of what I call information richness, that kind of perceptual density of offerings.
It might seem like pure architectural theory, but there are certainly new vistas in Innsbruck. You could say the ski jump is pre-parametric. It's still angular, although odd angles. It's middle period Zaha. Another Zaha, a different Zaha, can be found just across the valley. The Nordpark Railway takes off into pure parametric diversity and curves. Project architect Thomas Witzke takes us on a tour.
The Congress Station cantilevers in one of the main pedestrian axes of Innsbruck. And people's curiosity should be triggered because they see something foreign or unusual to them. At the same time, via these cantilevers and via these very open floating roof shells, we wanted to create a space that is very open and very transparent. So it integrates into the flow of the city and it is welcoming to the visitor.
Trains go from the city to the mountainside in under 9 minutes over a Zaha-designed S-curve bridge.
It's the idea to create a lively space. It's not only a kind of space where you transit through, but people are also gathering around the station, looking at the architecture, looking at each other. So we hope, and today I feel that you have a bit this sense that it's actually becoming a destination in its own right, so to say. This has been a fantastic site above the river, about 1,000 meters. So you really had to make something from these vistas. And that's why the station is articulated like a plateau above the city. It's almost pulled out of the steep mountainside and it darts in the direction of the valley. It's like a piece of melting ice sitting in the landscape, like a piece of a glacier.
The substructure is all concrete in a steel frame and they are clad in this frosted and in this milky glass. So it looked like, you know, ice dribbles. There is no demarcating line between these things. So it could look like a wing, it could look like an icicle, whatever.
It's kind of a novelty in terms of its form, in terms of its shape. It is new for Innsbruck. It is not a wooden typical log cabin that you find sometimes in Tyrolean architecture, but it relates to the natural landscape of the Alpine regions. The complexity of these geometries is challenging to control. The fluidity and the non-repetitiveness of the forms. We used a particular software in order to generate but also to control these shapes.
So the shapes are made possible by parametricism and computers. But there's more to it.
There's also a spiritual thing, you know, do you want to do angular or do you want to do curves? And the budget, frankly, the budget's for curves. Frank says this, Frank Geary says, flat piece of something, $1. Single curve, $2. Double curve, $10. That just about sums it up.
If a double curve is $10, this building is priceless. Completed this year, though not yet opened, it's the most extreme yet of Zaha's designs. It's organic, rolling. It slips and slides like plasticine. It's a new cultural center in Baku, capital of the once Soviet state of Azerbaijan. A huge show-off project for the ruling family. It gave Zaha the opportunity to really stretch her wings. It's the ultimate Zaha experience.
It's really basically three buildings. It's a library, convention center, and a museum, but they kind of merge into one. And it's a very odd city because it's a mixture of Russian neoclassical and Soviet architecture.
Baku's skyline is changing. New buildings are transforming the city at a rate of knots. Yet Azerbaijan's past is still apparent in the lives of the everyday Azeri people. Since the discovery of oil, Azerbaijan's economy has been one of the fastest growing in the world. Evidence of this new wealth abounds in Baku's boulevards.
You arrive there, and since you come out of the airplane, you smell the petrol. It's really strong. You feel that it was a communist country, all the big buildings. And now suddenly they want to make it beautiful, so they build new building, but they also make this fake facade. And behind you have all the old Soviet buildings. And it's quite dark and grey. And then you arrive at Zaha site and you have this explosion of white. And the light is very strong when it's sunny, so it's really white, it's like a flower. I don't think there's any building like that. It's a real palace in Europe been built since maybe, I don't know, since Louis XIV with Versailles.
It's a completely immersive field. It's re-examining the idea of the block. So it's no longer a perimeter block. It's not a podium with a tower. It's very exhilarating. Also, it can be very calming. It's like going to the park because it has that kind of rock-like, landscape-like quality, fluid quality. We found very good people to do all the tiling, which is vacuum formed. I think that the idea was to kind of make a completely seamless building, so the landscape literally crawls up the edge of the building and becomes like a mountain.
It was very important that whatever we propose actually breaks away from the rigid monumentalist Soviet architecture, and we wanted to reflect Azerbaijan's sensual side.
Turn the corner and this building changes. With every angle, every turn, it reveals something new and unexpected. It's one of the most remarkable structures I've ever seen.
There's a romanticism involved, and we wanted to do something very sensual, and at the same time, but we wanted to do something very strong.
Traces of Zaha's buildings, their outlines and curves, can be found in more ancient surfaces. Look closely, and you'll see in this Arabic calligraphy familiar shapes. Carved before us is a line of fluid forms, like Zaha buildings set in stone.
Fluidity in architecture in this region always existed. So if you look at like the Islamic architecture's interiors, you always see the calligraphy or ornamental floral patterns running through in all these interior surfaces, from carpets to walls to ceiling to dome. And you know, within our case, I mean, we use fluid spaces, which is continuously running and without being iconographic or without looking at the past, can relate to the region's understanding of architecture. It's like surfing, you know, like the wave, when the wave breaks, it peels from the ground and creates like a circular kind of arc.
This building is as extraordinary inside as it is out. From every floor and angle, it awes and astounds. Spaces unfold for conferences, concerts, and exhibitions. The building is not yet open to the public. Its spaces wait in anticipation of any activity. Its only residents are the government workers, who are tucked away behind the scenes, and the cleaners, who ceaselessly polish its surfaces.
Knows how to push us, the designers, the architects, to the limits. Always there's a pressure for innovation, and I think that's good kick.
People who were very eager to work for her, because in the architectural profession, particularly amongst young people, she is as a goddess, you know, She's very, very important and very exciting to work for. Extremely difficult to work for, I would imagine. I've never worked for her.
Zaha is, if you know her and if you understand her, and if you make allowances for the strength of her personality, is a very good collaborator. Very inspiring person. But you have to have patience to make these allowances. You have to give her room. If you try to constrain her, then she will explode.
And are you a tough boss?
I don't think so. I mean, if somebody taking the pissy, excuse me, Linga, I am tough, but actually I'm a pushover.
This is the biggest of Zaha's British achievements to date. The London Aquatic Centre, an iconic wave-like structure but landed 2 years ago in the Olympic Park. Its temporary seating wings are currently being removed to reveal its true, more fluid shape. It's a clear contrast with her first building in the UK, an angular Maggie's Cancer Care Centre in Fife, completed in 2006. In the years since, she's designed a museum of transport in Glasgow and a school in Brixton, London, the Evelyn Grace Academy. This is London's latest Zaha building, and finally, her first in the centre of the city. It looks like a tiny piece of Baku has just landed in Kensington Gardens. It's a renovation project of sorts, and still a building site. It's a Zaha-designed extension to the new Serpentine Gallery. It will be a restaurant and social space, housed under what feels like a floating roof.
Very nice. I want to become a photographer.
Coming full circle now that you are building all over the world, are there things you really want to do still which you are passionate about in certain parts of the world? London, for instance, here.
Yeah, I mean, I really would like to do something in London, not only because I've lived here, well, most of my life, and whenever you come across a site or a situation, you always imagine what it'd be like if you did something there, or it would be different. So this is like 40 years of me imagining things to happen, you know, with me in London. And I do have an interesting take on the city. But also through teaching at the AA, many years ago, I did always a London project, because I was curious about London. Also at the time, people really looked at buildings. You know, we would go out and we'll travel to, I don't know, all sorts of countries to look at projects. Then that changed. People started looking, traveling and doing esoteric stuff, looking at landscape, which was also very important. But so I think it gave us also knowledge on how to sort of, in one's head, to superimpose one reality on another. So I always had its projected realities on London, and that's why I've always wanted to build here.
So there is still a big opportunity for the city.
Yeah, I personally think there is, yeah, you know. It's been easier to achieve these things in places like Beijing than London, because, not because of regulations, but because, you know, you need to kind of convince me that it is possible to inhabit the city in a different kind of way.
Anybody who is a pioneer has massive challenges. And Zaha is somebody resolutely of her own time, but also well ahead of her time. And it's like night follows day. It wouldn't matter whether she was called Zaha Hadid, John Smith or Mary Jones. That's the territory. And it's a very, very tough territory to inhabit. What is so fantastic is the recognition she now has, and rightly so. And so this is a moment of incredible flowering for her. But she is a pioneer. She's still a pioneer.
Up to even 20 years ago, people did not anymore believe in what I always call the fantastic. They did not think that world is possible. And some people still don't think it's possible. And it is. You know, we do this really so you can be in a very simple space like this and feel good. And it's as simple as that. Maybe they can loan it to us, but while it's empty.
Yes.
To have a party. We can have a potato party here.
What kind of a party?
A potato party.
I don't know why you put up with it.
Well, we want to do a party with serving every kind of potato. But it looks like a potato chip anyway.